पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। द वेरी मीनिंग ऑफ द वर्ड उपनिषद एज गिवन बाय आदि शंकराचार्य इन हिज कमेंट्री ऑन अनदर उपनिषद इज दैट विस्डम विच लूजन्स द होल्ड ऑफ वर्ल्डलीनेस अपॉन अस एंड इवेंचुअली डिस्ट्रॉयज ऑल अवर वर्ल्डली बॉन्डेजेस। The very word Upanishad means that which destroys our worldly bondages. Are we holding the world or is the world holding us? I believe a man visited Sri Ramakrishna and was lamenting, "My responsibilities never end. The world is not sparing me. One after another, work is keeping me imprisoned." This businessman was lamenting. And then Sri Ramakrishna says, "All right, let's go for a little walk." So this visitor and Sri Ramakrishna started walking. Suddenly Ramakrishna caught hold of a tree, holding the tree very tightly. Extremely tightly, Sri Ramakrishna started screaming for help. "Save me! Save me! Bachao!" The visitor, businessman, said, "What is this? Funny? So ridiculous?" He came and said to Sri Ramakrishna, "Sir, you are saying, 'Save me! Save me!' It is you who is holding the tree. Let go of the tree, you are free. Why are you saying, 'Save me, save me, bachao'?" And then Sri Ramakrishna said, "That is what the case is with you too. You say the world is giving you responsibilities one after another. But examine, re-examine. In another Upanishad, namely Mundaka Upanishad, there is the word pariksha. Pariksha means examining, re-examining. Pariksha lokan karma chitan brahmanah nirvedamayat nastya kritakritena is a famous mantra of that Mundaka Upanishad, which says every one of us, if we were to examine how we are living, if we were to examine and be more aware of our own choices, be aware of, as Krishnamurti would put it, the movement of the self, moment to moment, then we would see that there is a fundamental error on our part. We are generating more and more of forms of bondage. We clearly see our contribution to the mess that our life seems to be. So in the light of it, we have been laboring last few evenings to show that as the mind rises to a greater state of maturity, refinement, it sees only two possibilities: work without any selfishness, and the highest possibility is work with no sense of "I am working, I am doing," no sense of "I" at all. When the sense of "I," described in countless ways by our own thoughts, evaporates, an unbelievable new perception of this very world comes into being. That was described in the two verses we saw yesterday, namely 6 and 7, in a manner appearing very poetic, the Upanishad said, someone in whom the sense of I, the ahankara, has dissolved, has gone away, finds everything in herself, and she finds herself in everybody and everything. It's like saying in the ocean, all the waves are in water, and water is in all the waves. Waves are in the water, water is in the waves, for the ocean is made of, you call it water, you call it waves, they are together, they are one homogeneous spread. In the same way, the person in whom ahankara, ego, has disappeared, perceives the entire creation as one, and with a touch of the language of devotion, we would call that very state of affairs as something where one perceives everything to be God and God alone. There is only God, there is nothing else, is the new perception, new understanding. How enviable is such a state, and what comes between such a state and us is our own thoughts. Thoughts again and again forming some sense of, some notion of, I am good, I am bad, and so on. Therefore it is, once more, saints like Ramana Maharshi would ask, inquire, who am I? Who are you? If you have fear, he would say, who has fear? If you have desire, he would say, who has desire? Why this question? This question is important because central to, as the core issue of all our miseries, is this bundle of memories forming the I. Now we take up this eighth mantra, which once more, using a different language though, describes the one divine truth which is outside and inside, which is all-pervasive, which is one's own true nature. If the ego dissolves, what does one discover as oneself, in oneself? This is the answer. Please see 8. Saparyagat chukramakayam avranam. Asnaviragam shuddhamapapavidham. Kavir manishi paribhu svayambhu. Yatha tathyatorthan vyadadhat shashvati bhyah samabhyah. Vyadadhat shashvati bhyah. Using the pronoun saha. Saha means that. Saha means he. So referring to that truth which in self-realization you find to be your own nature, but at present let us call it that as though it is far away. That truth of the Atma is Paryagat. Agat means gone. Pari means everywhere. It is gone everywhere. It's all pervasive. That is why we sometimes say Vedanta turns your understanding of the world or of yourself upside down. See, identified with your personality because of your own memories, the power of memories, the force of memories, the grip that memories have upon you, you take yourself to be just this body. Then, because thoughts make you believe you are just this body, you feel in this infinite world you are only a dust particle. That is the perception. When the Vedanta loosens and finally removes your identification with the body, with this personality, when no more thoughts are rising in you in quick succession, creating the illusion of I am this, I am that, when thoughts have said goodbye and you are able to remain in the silence of pure awareness, that whole perception, I am a little speck in the vast universe, changes to I have no boundaries whatsoever. Who am I? What am I? To describe it, we are using words here. But in that self-perception, there are no words. With no words coming in the way, you experience a certain boundless vastness about you, and this word paryagat would then be a matter of intimate experience, real experience, not just a figment of poetry. Paryagat, all pervasive. It is as simple as this, theoretically at least. Simple as this. Just as I use the word theoretically, not in the sense that it will never be realized. Just as in physics, you know, you ask a scientist, what is the basis of this atom bomb? He will, on the blackboard, write a simple diagram. Every atom has electrons, then a nucleus, and the nucleus has protons and neutrons. And you know, there is tremendous amount of energy in the nucleus. If we could break the nucleus, that energy would be released. In few sentences, he would say it, and that is true. Fission or fusion, he will explain in a few sentences. But to actually make an atom bomb, a whole lot of technology would be required. Even though a whole lot of sophisticated technology would be required to make the atom bomb, what the scientist said in a few sentences, one afternoon probably, writing a diagram on the blackboard, is not false. That is the truth. In pretty much the same way, what we are saying here is the simple basis. That is, in you and me, sometimes our being conscious, sometimes our not being so conscious, there is a quick succession of thoughts, all propelled by memories. And in such a scenario, a sense of I am such a person, I am a poor man, or I am a very emotional woman, whatever way, a certain idea, I am this, gets created. Just like the quick succession of cinema film makes maybe a horse running appear so real, as though there is a real horse. If the cinema show were to slow down, if the projector were to slow down, then you will find there is nothing running there. It is a slide, and another slide, a third slide, or they call it frame. A frame after a frame. In each frame, there is just a horse standing. Frame to frame, there is a slight difference. But when these frames come upon the screen in quick succession, the illusion of a horse in movement is made. So is the case here. Thoughts are in quick succession. Therefore, masters tell us, first slow down your thoughts. If you ask how, they give even some techniques. Do some pranayama, or observe your own breathing, or repeat a mantra. Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama, Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama. You repeat a mantra. with the strength of the mantra, support of the mantra, your thoughts become a bit slower. And then attempt being free from thoughts. Then attempt probably just watching thoughts or inquiring, who am I, and so on. These are the technology involved here. Finally, the truth conveyed by all these sages, enlightened souls, is as simple as this. If the thoughts are not creating pictures and scenarios, you will see yourself very differently than before. When needed, you will play your role. At other times, which is a lot of time, which is abundant time, which is 99% of the time really, to play all your roles, you actually need only 1% of the 24 hours in a day. 99% of the time, it is free time. You are free. Once more, I don't mind giving an analogy of physics. They say in an atom, the space occupied by electrons and nucleus is less than 1,000th or 1/10,000th of the total space. An atom mostly is all hollow. But made of atoms is everything, including a solid block of iron. It looks so solid. But the analysis, according to physics, is that it's made of atoms, and each atom, the building block, is to a large extent hollow. The sense of solidness is relative. In the same way, the sense of, but I have responsibilities, I am mother of three children, and I have a job also, and I do this, I do that. A sense of, you see, I looks very solid. However, if thoughts slow down, or to use Bhakti Marga's language, if love of God gets intense in you, your whole role, multifarious role, turns out to be a drop in the bucket. Paryagat becomes an inside experience. What is more, because of some reason, the body may fall sick. Every one of us gets old. So sickness, old age, and some other problems, in spite of them all, in love of God, that is the Bhakti Bhasha, or in this seeing that, hey, I am actually existence awareness. I am Sat Chit. In this new seeing, the problems all put together, all bundled up, is only a very small affair. So Paryagat, which literally means all pervasive, is a very reassuring word for us. Paryagat points to that spiritual dimension in us which is very vast. Today we are caught in the material dimension of ours, which has made us feel so limited, helpless and hapless. We don't have to be so. Saparyagat, Shukram, every one of us in our true nature as the Atma is Shukra. Shukra means white, brilliant, bright, radiant. Akayam, though we have a body, we actually are not limited by this body. This kaya, this body, is a passing show. The body comes and the body goes. We are free of its limitations. Avranam. Vrana is wound. Some damage, some injury takes place. Vrana. If we are not the body at all, then what happens to the body also is not our botheration. Somebody went to Ramana Maharshi and said, for last 7 years I have been having an ailment, some roga. I have been unlucky. God apparently has decided not to bless me with good health. I have body pain, all this, you know, some ailment. Maharshi looked at him very kindly, but then said, "You know, I sympathize with you. However, really speaking, leave this ailment aside. The body itself is an ailment. The body itself is an ailment on the spirit. See, when you have a wound, vrana, every day you have to nurse it, change the bandage, wash it and put some powder or some ointment and again bandage. A lot of care is to be taken. Isn't that what we do for this body? Every day we wash it. You know, when I come for lecture series, I wash this ailment called my body twice to be able to give a lecture for some extra freshness. Morning I take bath, afternoon again in this pleasant weather of Pune. You may say, what pleasant? You come to Banaras and see. Come, Banaras is a boiling cauldron at this time. You will remember not just your Ishtadevata, Rama or Krishna. In Banaras, you will remember all gods. It is so hot. Compared with that, yeah, even 2 p.m. in Pune, if you stand outside, it is so pleasant. But even then, I take another bath at 4 o'clock and have tea and come over here. Because the body, your body, my body, a young man's body as well as an old lady's body, this body, in as much as every few hours it sweats and then it has all these problems, needs wash, it is itself like a roga. So Maharshi Ramana said, the body itself is a roga, an ailment, and then in your case, it has another ailment. He advised the visitor who had this health problem, his usual remedy, find out who you are. Inquire, who has this disease? I, who am I? That is, you work on the psychological side of the whole issue. In every matter, I have remarked on this before also, there is a physical side, then there is a psychological side. If while getting down from the stage, suppose I fall, physical side is I get injured. In 2 minutes that injury goes, the pain goes. But typically you and I being what we are very image conscious. When we fell down, I fell down in front of all. And they were videographing also, they had not turned it off. And there was a newspaper man, what if the picture comes in newspaper tomorrow? You know, a sadhu suffers a big fall and readers take it is a moral fall. You start imagining. Image conscious. This is what we call psychological side. The physical pain goes away in 2 minutes. But memories, at midnight, 1 o'clock I get up and so many people saw me falling. Anyway, good attendance is less. If imagine if 200 people had come. Of course. Aside from this humor, in everything, food and clothes and position and status and in everything in your life, just examine. There is a objective physical side, then there is a subjective psychological side, that is what your mind makes of it. The mind can make a mountain out of a molehill, or the other way also, a molehill out of a mountain. In reality, if we were to work on the psychological side by questioning our own mind's conclusions, then we rise to a different level of state of consciousness, then avranam asnaviram shuddham, extremely pure, apapaviddham, not at all affected by any sin whatsoever. For sin and merit, papa and punya, both belong to a certain plane, and in spiritual enlightenment, you go to a higher plane. You rise to a higher plane. Therefore, it is often compared with waking up from a dream. In your dream, maybe a tiger killed you, or maybe you killed tiger or even people. You did, people did something to you. In a dream, 100 things might have happened. When you wake up, the whole dream world becomes invalid. इसका कुछ मतलब ही नहीं है. In that way, papa, punya, all of them become invalid, irrelevant in this new perception, which doesn't mean that you become utterly insensitive and irresponsible. It doesn't mean that yesterday you had taken 1,000 rupees from somebody and because now you have a new spiritual understanding, you say what, who taken, who took from whom. The other man comes and asks, can you give me my 1,000 rupees back? First find out who you are. That is all distortion and misuse of the philosophy, not that kind of insensitivity. What is meant is, yes, you may have made mistakes. Mistake is a mild word, sin is a strong word. And in the law of the land, a third word is crime. So something going wrong is sometimes called sin, religious language, crime, legal language, and mistake, ordinary language. You made some mistake, and now how far are you in the grip of memories, and to what extent can you look at things objectively? And looking at things objectively, neither running away from any sense of responsibility nor unnecessarily brooding over what went wrong, you do what is appropriate with dignity. You do with a pure heart. If you had harmed somebody, hurt somebody, you go and say, I am extremely sorry. I would like to compensate for that. And you do it without any false prestige. In our egoistic existence, we have all kinds of abhimana. I made a mistake, but I cannot go and apologize to him. To that fellow, never. Before you, I will confess. And so on. I will go to the padri and confess. Confession, we already talked of it other day. So, papa, that is sin, does not bother you in the sense of you will have the silence, you will have the dignity to face it all. While internally, now we said yesterday, Krishna Arpanam, you belong to Sri Krishna. All that happened at your hands was Sri Krishna's play. And all that will happen now, suppose society puts you in jail for some mistake you made. So Krishna Arpanam, you say, and you go in the jail. In fact, in the jail you will have much less disturbance for your japa, tapa, dhyana and so on. Undisturbed. Outside all these people constantly trouble you. There you sit and Sri Krishna Sharanam Mama. See, it's all in the mind. If you have a different mindset, what is a big problem becomes a wonderful opportunity. So apapa vidham, that core, that pure self principle, Atma in you, has no papa. The personality is part of the game. Kavihi. Kavi here means all-knowing. With the body and mind, you have limitations. With the pure awareness as your nature, you are all-knowing. Manishi, you are very wise. Paribhuhu, going everywhere was Pariyagat, and being everywhere is Paribhuhu. Swayambhuhu, a string of words is given here. We may not go into elaborate details of every word, but the idea of the mantra is different sadhakas get inspired by different pointers. You know, in the bhakti context, you have 1,000 names of Lord Vishnu. Sometimes your children or grandchildren may ask you, why 1,000 names? One or two names are enough, no? But we have 1,000 names of Vishnu, 1,000 names of Shiva, 1,000 names for a number of other god forms. The idea is, there is a saying in the Bhagavatam, Ata khenapi upayena mana krishne niveshayet. By hook or crook, beg, borrow or steal, Make your mind stay in Krishna. So if Vishwa doesn't appeal to you, go for Vishnu. If Vishnu doesn't on one fine morning inspire you for whatever reason, go for Vashatkara. Otherwise, go for Damodara, go for Krishna, for Rama. Thousand names of varieties, such variety. In other words, somewhere or the other, fix your mind in God. Same way in Jnana Marga also, all these in fact internally are connected. It is the same truth expressed in many ways. Swayambhuhu means coming on one's own, not caused by something else. Yata tatyataha arthan vyadadat shashvatibhyaha samabhyaha. This supreme principle with which upon the destruction of your ego, you will find or discover oneness. Today you have a sense of you are small and there is God who is infinite. When your ego is gone, you will find I am one with God, I am inseparable from God, God is in me, I am in God. In this way, that oneness, upon finding that oneness, the Upanishad rishis venture to the extent of saying, that truth which I am allots responsibilities to all the devatas, to Indra and Varuna, to Yama, or to, we have 33 gods, according to some shastras, there are 33,000 gods, means they are all powers. Wind also is God, light is God, rain is God. All the phenomena of the universe are represented as controlled and managed by some God principles. So this vast universe with countless forces, today in physics you may say it is magnetism and gravity and weak interaction force, strong interaction force, electromagnetic force, heat, light, there are some, they are all the gods of physics. In our shastras, it was Indra and Varuna and Yama and so on. Here also, the samabhyaha. Samabhyaha literally means ears, and then by interpretation it means the presiding deities of ears, devatas. So all the forces in this creation are empowered by this principle, and this principle alone is the truth. To derive once more from Sri Ramakrishna, he gives a beautiful simple example. You take a vessel, put some water in it, cut some vegetables, potatoes and onion and so on, and put the pieces in that vessel. And stand and watch. Nothing is happening. Now, turn the oven on below the vessel. The stove is on, flames rise. The oven is getting heated. In couple of minutes, the water starts boiling. And isn't it amazing? The pieces of potato and onion, lady's finger and tomato all start moving. Some of them up and down, some of them even circular movement, whatever way. Sri Ramakrishna, if you read his all-time classic, the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, originally in Bengali, I think it is Ramakrishna Kathamrita. In some other languages, it is translated as Ramakrishna. Dvaita, Advaita, Vishishta Advaita. Everybody and anybody would be benefited by his words. Giving this analogy of the vegetable pieces on their own were sitting quietly in water. Once there was the energy given to them by fire, they started moving. In the same way, here it is said, Arthan vyadadhat shashvatibhyaha samabhyaha. The one sat-chit principle, existence awareness principle, call it Brahman, call it God, call it the absolute reality, call it the Atma in everyone. That one truth empowers the phenomenal forces. It makes the wind to blow. It makes the fire to burn. It makes the sun to rise and set. or with today our knowledge of science, it makes the earth go around the sun. In other words, what science may call gravitational force, electromagnetic force, the different forces, all of them are whatever they are, thanks to this truth. This truth empowers it all. Elsewhere in the Taittiriya Upanishad, we have a poetic line, Bhishasmadvatapavate Bhishodeti Suryaha Bhishasmadagnischendrascha Mrityurdhavati Panchama Iti. A small portion of another Upanishad. Bhisha means out of fear. Asmat Bhisha, out of the fear of this one God, Vatapavate, wind blows. Bhishasmad Agnihi Tapati, fire burns. Even Lord Yama, who is busy all the time going and taking life out of people, as we have a description, Pran Le Jane Wala. Why doesn't he take a day off? Why doesn't he go to Lonavala to cool his heels? No! According to the Upanishad, he is also afraid. Everybody does his job or her job out of fear of this one principle. Fear is a certain word used in certain context. Otherwise, the Supreme God is full of love. Nobody needs to really fear, but in a manner of saying. What is meant is that Supreme God makes this whole universe run, the outer grosser universe and the inner universe of subtle forces, karma and karma phala. There is a physics outside and there is a physics inside also. Even a bad thought that we may entertain has its own reaction. Outer physics, you know, third law of Newton says every action has its own equal and opposite reaction. That is about property of matter, of objects. Every action has equal and opposite reaction. There is a physics inside. Every karma has corresponding karma phala. Even a thought has its own reaction, maybe much weaker. A thought may not bring so much of reaction as if one were to do that. If I were to speak a bad word and hurt somebody's sentiments, then the phala is much more. But if whole morning I sit and plan, I meet that man in the afternoon, how shall I sing his praise? First I'll call him Ullu Ke Patte. That is, 108 names I prepare. Ashtottara Shatanama it is called. So I prepare, I roll up my sleeves. Finally, for whatever reason, when he actually comes, my mind changes. Better not take risk today. Because I call him Ullu Ke Patte, then he may break my teeth. It's not worth taking the risk. So all I did was, for 2 or 3 hours in the morning, I prepared gali. Lekin diya nahi. Then will there be reaction? Us karma ka phal? Bahut halka sa hoga, jarur. Ek to samay barbad hua. Usi vakat, instead of preparing my enemy's 108 names, if I had taken Lord Shiva's 108 names, you know, Shivo Maheshwara Shambhu Pinaki Shashi Shekaraha Vamadevo Virupaksha Kapardini Lalohitaha Shankara Shula Panischa Katwangi Vishnuvallabaha and so on. There are 108 beautiful names of Lord Shiva. Yadi wo Bhagavan Shiva ke 108 naam leta, kuch punni aata mujhko. Uske jagah maine apne dushman ke liye Ullu Ke Patte Tasmai Namaha I had prepared. But dopar ko wo aaya dushman samne, man badal gaya. To halka sa nuksan isme bhi hai, even if you just think of that. And if you do it more, and along with gali, if you go with fisticuffs, then the result would be much more also. So like Newton's third law, every karma has its own karma phala. So that is the meaning, and what makes it all possible is this power of the Self. Now we arrive at a portion. The next six mantras are a bit tricky. In a sense, they are secondary, but in another sense, they have their own importance. They are not on the plane of the highest self-knowledge, on the plane of Atma-jnana, but they have their own importance because you and I live on a certain plane of a certain identification. The reality of our life is we do have ego, we do have desires, we do have anger, we do have regrets. We have many, many forces pulling us in many directions. Therefore, I would say the next six mantras, and we will take, they are in two bunches. The next 9, 10, and 11 are one bunch. Then 12, 13, 14 are a second bunch. We will take one bunch at a time. This bunch doesn't talk of the highest realization. It talks about a certain blending, certain combination of two skills or two activities. I'll make it clear very soon. The first bunch, once more, 9, 10 and 11, talks about what technically we would call karma and upasana. I already said this is not talking about that total inner freedom. Why? Neither karma nor upasana gives to anyone the complete freedom. Therefore, the whole topic is one notch below the main teaching of the Upanishad. The Upanishads are mainly meant to give liberation, what shall we say, liberating knowledge. So this whole series of talks has been titled The Liberating Vision. These mantras are not about liberation, and yet they are important. Using the words avidya for karma and vidya for upasana, the rishis of this Ishavasya Upanishad say that if you are truly wise, you would do both these together. You would blend these. We will see the significance of it all one by one, a little by little. Let's read the three mantras now. Andantam apravishanti ye vidyamupasate ततो भूय इवते तमः य उविद्यायां रताः अन्यदेवाहुर्विद्यया अन्यदाहुरविद्यया इति शुश्रुमधीराणाम् येनस्तद्विचचक्षिरे विद्यां चाविद्यां च यस्तद्वेदो भयं सः अविद्यया मृत्युं तीर्त्वा विद्ययामृतमश्नुते. सो यू नोटिस्ड दैट सेवरल टाइम्स द वर्ड्स दैट केम वेर अविद्या एंड विद्या. द वेदिक लैंग्वेज, उपनिषद्स आर पार्ट ऑफ वेदास. द वेदिक लैंग्वेज इज नॉट as simple or straight as today's Sanskrit language. On one hand, knowledgeable, and on the other, who love to teach. Very few people have become teachers. They have gone here and there, so many others, professional courses, etc. So, let us say there is a school which envisages everything but actually ends up giving good amount of physical exercises, you know, nature walks, you know, horse riding and swimming pool and everything is there. But no proper teachers for the academics inside the classroom, in a manner of saying. I don't limit mental exercise to inside the classroom only. Manasa vyapara can take place anywhere, but in a manner of saying. How sad it would be. And the Ishavasya would say, that school goes to thick darkness. Or the children there, the teachers there, or the first, the principal there goes to thick darkness. And the second line of the mantra says, if there is another school, wonderful faculty, physics and maths and chemistry and social studies and, you know, arts and painting and music, everything. So every child has a very good grip on all this knowledge, but very poor on the physical front. They are mostly inside. Their manasa vyapara, mental activity is very good. Sharp IQ. IQ is developed. EQ also is okay. But physically, they are all the time indoor maybe. They are not outdoor. They don't do good exercise. They are timid. They would like to. They explore the world of the internet. But they have not explored the real world outside. They don't know what is behind their classroom, what plant is growing. But if you ask them some question, they'll say, I'll show it to you, and I'll Google it up and show you. Any number of trees they will show you. Today's children are like that. They're Google children. People are getting more and more into the world of the net. Other day somebody said to me, two nets are required in life. Sone ke liye mosquito net, jeene ke liye internet. ये दो दे दो हमको और कुछ नहीं चाहिए. दिन दिन भर इंटरनेट के सामने रहो, क्लिक क्लिक क्लिक, और रात को मस्किटो नेट बांध के सो जाओ. तो इंटरनेट और मस्किटो नेट के बीच हो गई उनकी जिंदगी. एंड उपनिषद क्रिटिसाइजेस इट. एनीबडी गोस सो मच इन द मेंटल वर्ल्ड. आप खुद या अपने घर में कोई हमेशा किताब किताब किताब, टीवी, किताब, मैगजीन, अंधम तम प्रविशंति. एंड समबडी एल्स डजंट टेक एनी इंटरेस्ट इन दोज थिंग्स, ऑलवेज आउटडोर, दैट इज ऑल्सो नॉट गुड. देर हैज टू बी ए बैलेंसिंग. दीज मंत्रास एज आई इंट्रोड्यूस्ड ऑन वन हैंड आर कंसिडर्ड सेकेंडरी. इनफैक्ट देर आर मेनी टीचर्स ऑफ ईशावासी उपनिषद हु जस्ट रश थ्रू दिस, हु डोंट गिव इम्पॉर्टेंस एट ऑल, बट दे हैव लॉट ऑफ बेयरिंग ऑन अवर रियल लाइफ, दी on a lower level, you see, which is the reality for most of us. The Upanishad says, physical activity has its merit, but limitations also. Mental activity has its charm, but its limitations also. If you are able to erase your ego and see God everywhere, then there is no injunction, no order, no advice of any kind to you. So your life is already fulfilled. But one notch below, when you have not erased your ego, you have a sense of individuality, you have very many worries and botherations, as in Hindi you have, you know, humko bahut sari pareshaniya hai. Pareshani. One word I hear a lot in Banaras is this pareshan. Every day one person at least tells me, hum bahut pareshan, they say pareshan. परेशान है क्या हुआ आपको, सम स्टोरी, हम बहुत परेशान हैं, आप कुछ करो, सो ऑन. सो यू एंड आई हैव, दैट इज माई परेशानी, दैट समबडी कम्स एंड सेज हम परेशान हैं. सो हर सबको, हर एक को कुछ ना कुछ परेशानियाँ है, वरीज. सो दैट इज द सेकेंड लेवल. फॉर आत्मज्ञानी देर इज नो, फॉर रमण महर्षि, फॉर रामकृष्ण, फॉर निसर्गदत्त एंड सच सच, यू नो, lofty lives, there is no pareshani. But you and I have a number of, for us, this holistic way of living, taking both physical and mental together, is necessary. The 10th mantra says, Anyat ahuhu vidyaya. Anyat ahuhu avidyaya. We must recognize that the physical and the mental have their own plus and minus points. Neither of them can be ignored. Neither of them can be taken, that is, just one of them alone taken as, this is enough for me. मैं पढ़ा लिखा हूँ और पढ़ते रहूँगा लिखते रहूँगा और इफ somebody says that is enough for me, I don't have to do anything physical, then one is mistaken. One has to carry both physical and mental. One has to have a holistic mix. Another very interesting point here is, one notch below, as I have been using the expression, one notch below self-knowledge, try what as you may, you are always trying to synthesize all these aspects. You know, today in personality development, it's not just broad categories of physical and mental, there are subdivisions. There is even voice training. There are even training given to people, etiquette, manners. In Chennai, I am in touch with an organization. That organization conducts programs for anyone who is going abroad, let's say to Europe or US or Australia, even for a month or two, maybe for some company work. This organization called Global Adjustments, what they do is, they conduct a workshop. When you are spending 2 months in Holland, take care about certain things, because the culture there is different. Though most of the hours you are in your technical work, but you do spend time in the evening here and there, you will meet the local people, you will meet men and women, you will meet children, you will meet old people in parks or restaurants or, and there should not be misunderstanding. So various etiquettes, various behavioral patterns, various forms of greeting, what you may say, what you may not say. For example, I was told there that Indians have a habit of asking personal questions and Europeans, it seems, don't like personal questions. You have just met Mr. Johnson this evening only in Amsterdam. You are a software engineer who has come for some work, and over a cup of or a glass of drink, you are, hello Johnson, glad to meet you, are you married? That fellow gets, what has this fellow, why is he worried about I am married or not? But we think it is kushala prashna. Ek dusre ko, jaan pehchan lo, jeena asaan ho. Let us know each other. Are you married? How many children? Who is doing what? We may even end up asking, how much is your bank balance? Normally you don't go that far, though we get curious, But we hold back. That much we don't need to attend a training in Chennai or anywhere else, By the way, I think they have a branch in Pune also, Global Adjustments, if I remember right. They have elaborate workshops. They brought out even a CD, anyone going abroad. In fact, their main job is the other way. People coming to India for 2 months, not 2 months, 2 years, 3 years, assignments in multinational companies. This organization holds programs for them, for the foreigners, to know India, to make their stay in India comfortable. Completely A to Z guidance is given. So I am calling that as the holistic education. If you are a software professional, you go to Amsterdam and you cannot say, I am a software professional, don't ask me to learn anything else. In fact, sometimes there can be such misunderstanding, they may put you in jail. In Gulf countries also sometimes, I believe in some Gulf countries, you just overtake, it can be taken as a serious offense. Especially you have overtaken some native, Saudi Arabian, and you are not a Saudi Arabian. So he may be going dead slow and you may be getting impatient. Kya gaadi hai, raasta nahi de raha hai aur slow ja raha hai. Then finally you lose patience and you overtake. The police will arrest you, and without any question, they put a big fine, sometimes they may deport you, some severe punishments. At that time in the police station there, you cannot say, "Sir, please see, I am a software professional. I don't know all these, you know." You cannot say, you are supposed to know. Ignorance is no excuse to law. So in that way, you and I on many occasions discuss holistic self-development, holistic education for children, holistic vision in different spheres of human activity. That is what the three mantras are talking about. The Rishi says, "Iti shushruma dhiranam." We have heard this way from wise people, our forefathers, our gurus, our acharyas. Ye naha, those, or they taught us, naha means to us, vichachakshire. And in the third of the set of three, the mantra says, you have to carry vidya and avidya. See the word ubhaya. Ubhaya means carry both. Take care of your body and take care of your mind also. Don't take care of one at the expense of the other. And to others also, give the gift of mental knowledge as well as physical training. Add to it voice training, etiquette training, manners training, verbal training, how to dress, so many things, table manners, right? A to Z, all of them. So Upanishad, in these six mantras, 9, 10, 11, one bunch, 12, 13, 14, another bunch, makes, let me admit, a diversion. Upanishads are generally not talking of these things. Their main topic is, what is it which can set you unconditionally free, which can set your ego at rest, which can set your, you know, fear and worries at rest. Inwardly, you come upon a certain silence, a certain innocence, certain simplicity, where nobody can hurt you, nor do you hurt anyone. So it is a different level. That's the main teaching of the Upanishads. But all the Upanishads do this. All the Upanishads. For example, the Taittiriya, to which I already made a couple of references. Taittiriya Upanishad has those well-known statements, Satyam Vada, Dharmam Chara, speak truth, live virtue, Swadhyayan Ma Pramadaha, never give up your daily studies. It talks about taking good care of guests, Atithi Devo Bhava. These are all teachings of moral values. They are not the primary teaching of Upanishads. But all the Upanishads do, except perhaps Mandukya, except one or two Upanishads, most of them do a little digression, cover up a few secondary topics, then get back. Here also, by the 15th mantra, we are going to get back somewhat closer to self-knowledge, if not fully. The mantras 1, 4 and 5, and 6, 7, 8, they were all focused on self-knowledge. Mantra 2 was Karma Yoga. Mantra 3 was a general, you know, condemning selfish life. But 1, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 6 mantras so far were minding the main job of the Upanishads. That is Atmajnana, liberating wisdom. Avidyaya Amrityum Tirtva, Vidyaya Amritam Ashnute. Employing a rather dramatic language, by attending to karma, by attending to the physical aspect of life, by doing justice to the physical aspect of life, you will go across, you will go beyond mrityu. Quite a dramatic language. You will go beyond death. You will scratch your head, but going beyond death, that liberation is only through self-knowledge. How come by this karma, whether it is Vedic rituals, various yajna, yaga, havana, homa, sandhya vandana, agni, hotras, samit, arpana, and there are so many orthodox people are into it. Or it is social service, nishkama karma, or as we today touched upon, physical exercises, workouts, jogging, yoga, pranayama, with the focus on physical side. See, yoga can be done with a very spiritual understanding also. But if in an ordinary context, a man is doing some yoga, he is concerned about his bodily well-being, his tummy going down, or his, some of his headache or sinus going away, diabetes coming under control, then that person is focusing in his practice of yoga, he is eyeing the physical benefits. So whatever it is, how can that karma, whatever way you interpret it, take you beyond death? When we look up again commentaries by Shankaracharya and others, we find that the word mrityu also here is not in the sense of the dying, as the Bhajagovindam said, punarapi maranam, punarapi jananam, not in that sense, but mrityu here is in the sense of a whole lot of unnecessary complications in life. If we neglect our physical dimension of life, we invite lot of complications. We may be a great scholar, and we are lost in our study of more books, writing more books, without realizing that the Madhya Pradesh has become very big, let's say. Then one day, doctors say, immediately get admitted. There are multiple, what you call, blockages, arteries. But sir, I am a double PhD. That is why all this happened. You, in your PhD, you need never care to do proper diet and proper exercise and so on. So that kind of then don't we say in all our language, what? I have to give a lecture at that conference, international conference. Doctor says, if you go to give lecture there only, you will drop dead. Get admitted. There are serious blockages. Then we say, hai hai mar gaye. We use the word mar gaye. That is this mrityu. Sachmuch aap nahi mar rahe hain. But the kind of complications you created is almost like dying. Same thing happens to the other fellow who is taking very good care of the physical dimension of oneself or the surroundings, take it all together, but not at all training his or her mind, emotion, poetic appreciation, appreciation of music, art, and so on. So one is underdeveloped on the mental side. That fellow also down the road may enjoy good physical health, but will end up in lot of relationship problems. Somebody would one day on his face say, aha, you have a wonderful physical form, but inside it is all empty. I don't want to spend time with you. You are such a bore, handsome bore. Somebody will say, then it will pinch him. Then that fellow also, who is physically very good, but dumb fellow, there are some. In this world we see, that fellow feels same thing, hai hai mar gaye. He also experiences mrityu. So this is a little poetic language. Avidyaya mrityum tirtva, by, please note, avidya is karma here. By right performance of karma, by right performance of physical acts which need to be done, by doing justice to the physical dimension, you will be free of all that hai hai mar gaye. You will not have such occasion. Lot of complications can be prevented. The good old saying goes, prevention is better than cure. From childhood itself, or whenever you realized, that day onwards you took good care of the physical side of life, then you prevent a whole lot of complications. In the same way, vidyaya, by taking good care of mental side, subtler, sukshma. Then amritam ashnute. Again, this amrita is not in the sense of the immortality gained by atmajnana. That is the ultimate amritatva. This amritatva is in a relative sense. When both body and mind are well developed, then we definitely enjoy a certain blissful life. Wherever we go, suppose we have conversation skills, suppose we have the emotional maturity to mix with different kinds of people without getting hurt easily, without getting bruised or embarrassed, or without feeling like fish out of water. There are some very bright people who are good at their work, but take them to any party, they feel fish out of water. They don't feel comfortable because they are totally not developed. That should not be. We are not saying everybody should party all the time, but there should not be unnecessary sense of, I don't know, I feel very uncomfortable here, you know. I don't know how to talk and how to stand. I don't know whether I'm holding my soft drink properly. I don't know whether I've zipped my pants, checking 3 times, you know, in the process opening it, which was okay before. Some people are like that. They feel very nervous. They feel very nervous about being in, you know, various circles. They feel nervous about people less qualified than them. They feel nervous about people more qualified than them. Richer than them make them nervous in one way. And poorer people, you know, people poorer than them also make them feel uncomfortable. Ultimately, it is only very few people with whom they can really, you know, interact. And the worst tragedy is people are at peace only with machines, internet and mosquito net. Any other contact, you know, you do it. You tell wife or husband, I have to check emails. Like that is very sad. And the absence of that embarrassment, absence of any such discomfort, you are ready to go anywhere, you are ready to mix with people. And if they are all taking something which you don't want to take, you have the plainness and openness to say, oh, I don't drink these things. Can I have, you know, some drink which you take, some food, you know. Even by mistake, some buttons were not closed. Somebody says, sir, your buttons are not, you know, put. You have the simplicity, plainness of mind to say, oh, thank you for telling me. Quickly you put it and forget next moment. How many educated people actually have this kind of plainness of personality? They don't. They may be double PhD, but they fret and fume. They feel, they feel very embarrassed. They feel fish out of water in many situations because they have developed themselves only in one sphere, but not on the whole. So, one thing I wanted to say, with that I will say and conclude. This synthesis, these shlokas, and generally what is said, what is described as holistic education, attempts a synthesis. Synthesis is a technical word. Some sports and some games and some studies and some art and some music and some karate and some, like that in schools, you know, they have number of things. And there is a belief that if my child does maximum of them, there is a holistic development, which is almost true but not really true. You, by putting things together, you don't come to Purnatva. Putting lot of things together may be better than no exposure to varieties of things. It's good that a child is exposed to many. For actual Purnatva, for feeling free, feeling full, feeling very light, it is a deeper thing. If not self-knowledge, that may be hard. The child has to be helped to think independently, to face himself or herself. The child has to have a spirit of inquiry. Krishnamurti schools talk about it, attempt it. Many other schools also talk about it, attempt it. But Krishnamurti's literature dwells a lot on this. Repeatedly he says, academics are important, various arts and other things are important, but he starts saying, do you create some fear in the mind of the child? Unless you pass here, unless you pass there. Beta, boxing bhi thoda seekh lo, baad mein nahi hoga. Beta, ye bhi seekho. Beta, wo bhi seekho. Many parents, you know, put pressure. They are also under stress. Many parents are like that. In the name of holistic education, they are trying to give many skills to the child. They also are stressed because beta aata hai, wo thoda doodh peeta hai, kuch khata hai. Then they take him to this class. Then they brought him back. Next day they take him to this class. Either or, maximum they want to teach. This synthesis, and great teachers like J. Krishnamurti have said, perfection is not achieved by adding things. You have to water the plant at its base. It's not by putting together. And what is that watering the base, watering the roots of the tree? To that child or to yourself, in a little modified context, even as, okay, quite a few things you have included in your life, you are trying to grow holistically. Apart from just bringing many things and putting them together, you need to inquire and say, do I have fear? Am I under pressure? Do I have some complex? Am I trying to show off to somebody? Some of these things one needs to be aware of, and one needs to eliminate them. Then one goes about learning quite a few things with a open mind, with a learning mind, with a childlike fresh mind. Otherwise, simply adding a number of things to make a report card which shows science, social studies, maths, and then some 8 kinds of extracurricular activities. Ah, my girl has gone to all these classes. Just that long list can be bad also. The child might be just exhausted, stressed, confused. So synthesis is an inferior approach, but I used a figurative expression. Watering the base is the more mature approach, which is also taken up in good schools by good educators. The good educators impart a number of skills to a child with very little pressure or fear or comparison, without making the child feel miserable that usne bahut seekha, mai piche pada hu, or iske zyada mai pada, you know, I am far ahead of this other child. So this pride or this guilt, this shame, this comparison, without those distortions coming into the mind, can teachers impart skills, various skills. If somebody picks up well singing, good. If the child doesn't pick up well, without making him feel low, maybe you can do some counseling, and maybe he need not learn. He is not meant for music. He is lovingly told, oh, you could not, come here. You like games, right? Come here. So the child's mind is not hurt. Otherwise, this mad education system, you know, fills the report card with many things, but it has hurt the psyche of the child. Somebody doesn't do, sometimes even though it is not allowed by law, the teacher's hand goes up. If you don't perform well, then are you educating or are you, you know, damaging the mind of the child? So these issues all get related to these mantras. How to combine karma and upasana, physical, mental, and all the sub-varieties of self-training or training others to come out with a truly healthy blend with least damage. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.